Welcome, ladies and gentlemen. Last year we did this for the first time, and I think we're going to turn it into a bit of an annual tradition at the CNA conference, the CEO panel, and you can see right off the bat that they have the matching socks for our CEO panel, so.
Well, we get it started right. Yeah. Good afternoon. All right.
Here we go. So once again, I'm not going to do long introductions for our panelists because I want to save as much time as possible to hear their comments, but I am joined by the CEOs of Bruce Power, OPG, and NB Power, Jeffrey Lyash, Gaetan Thomas, and of course, Mike Renchuk. So welcome to all of you. Thank you for being here.
Thank you.
Yeah. And we have lots of ground to cover today and maybe even one or two little surprises. So let's talk about the future and let's talk about the revitalization of Canada's nuclear fleet. So give us a sense of where you are as a company right now and what you see as the big challenges and opportunities. Gaetan, do you want to go first?
Well, you know, this industry has had many challenges, but you know what we've been doing in this country, we've actually showed that we can, you know, we can do refurbishment, and we're counting on our friend Jeff to lead the way. You know, learning from our mistakes and obviously at Pointe-la-Prairie, but you know, Pointe-la-Prairie is working well, and so we've overcome that. The majority of the plants are working well, but the opportunities are humongous. Okay, climate change is here to stay. And it's not going away, and we've seen it in New Brunswick incredibly over the last 5 years. The accumulation of the cost for the province is in the hundreds of millions of dollars when you look at the floods and so on. So if we're going to combat that war on climate change, we're going to have more nuclear, and we have some really good opportunities with small modular reactors, and we're glad to work with our partners. You know, Saskatchewan is interested. So I believe that the door is opening up for new nuclear, or en français, nouveau nucléaire.
Okay. All right, Mike.
I'll let my older counterpart go here first.
Okay.
Oh, God. Renchuk's always such a good guy to have around.
All right, I'll go first.
I got it. I think, so the future here is very bright for nuclear. You know, there are a couple of big decisions that need to be made in the life of a nuclear industry. And in Canada, you've already made the first and very important one, and that is to commit to investment in extending the life of the existing fleet another 30 to 50 years. Let's think about 50 years. This is a huge commitment. Gaetan, you started it with the Lepreau refurbishment. We learned a tremendous amount from that. Mike and I are following with Darlington and Bruce refurbishments. This is no small decision to be made, because as soon as you open up that window to 50 years, now you get a flood of innovation. Now you have a time horizon you can take technology and identify how to apply it to improve safety, production, cost, all of those things. And you can get a workforce excited about what their entire career looks like. And so, as I see it, there are two major decisions that have to be made in this decade. You've already made the first, well on the way to executing on it. The second, then, is building off that success. What role will nuclear play in the next wave of energy for Canada?
I'll talk about it from an aspect. Can you see all the way to 2064? You know, when I say that, right, our units will run right now all the way through 2064. And guess why we say 2064? It's such a long time into the future that the only thing that limited it was the financial rules on how far a lease could be extended to. So as we get a little further down the road, we can keep extending the lease out. So you may be saying 2074 before long. Can you see that far out? What will happen to technology in those next years that we can implement in our units to make them operate better, more reliably, longer? You think about the things that we're doing today and we're talking about. You know, we're making investments right now in containment filters that several years ago would have been a $60 million building, and now there are cartridges about this big. I have a couple of them on my desk. It effectively will negate the need for an evacuation zone around the plant in the event of a release, a postulated event of a release. It'll truly modernize how we're viewed. With the advents of artificial intelligence, it's comprehensible that an operator walking out into the field will be able to look at a piece of equipment, take some notes on it, and then if it needs maintenance, the work order is auto-generated by the computer based on the fact that we have over 40 years of records that were meticulously kept and recorded with the operating data. The CANDU fleet has had digital computers monitoring and controlling the facility since day one. It's not like it has to be updated. So we have the advent of the technologies that not only are here today, but that will evolve over time, that'll enable us to continue operation and extension. And I think it lays the groundwork when we're in this space is to talk about what we're talking about here today. And it's that next step in generating nuclear power for the mitigation of climate change, but also health care. You see, we're wearing our blue isotope socks here. We're one of the only industries in the world where we can make medical treatments at a scale that's large enough that can be distributed worldwide and used affordably. And it's quite a value proposition that we have to society when you look at our impact on the environment and our impact in people's health. We save lives every day in our industry. It goes far beyond electricity.
Mike, I can see up to 2065. Yeah. Because my dream was to live 105. So I'll be there to check on you.
James can push both of us around the control room in our wheelchairs. Where's James? So it'll be autonomous by then, so we won't have to push.
So, Gaetan, the theme of this panel is innovation. Let's talk about the innovations that were deployed in the refurbishment at Pointe-le-Preau, because obviously that's about a lot of different things, including safeguarding workers and improving efficiencies, reducing costs, et cetera.
Well, we were early, obviously, and when you look at it from an early point of view, but the most important innovation for us was really volume reduction. We were able to minimize dose, minimize exposure, and a lot of sophisticated automated machines that really eliminate a lot of exposure. But then we looked at data gathering, all the equipment reliability, online diagnostics, like Mike is talking about artificial intelligence, and people think it's something in the future. It's actually now. For instance, in New Brunswick, we're able to look at all the weather patterns all over the world, and we're able to pre-mobilize our crews, and this is why we've been so successful in restoring power much faster this year. So Mike is absolutely right. Because we've extended, and Jeb, because we've extended for 40, 50 years, we're now able to invest in the same kind of technology that other industries have done. You can't do that if your life is 10, 20 years. So that artificial intelligence is available, 3D, like walking into a plant, like you said, basically no paper, displaying your procedures on the wall, and then having real-time data, being able to see through walls. You have things that are invisible and they pop up on the screen, just walking with your safety glasses. We're experimenting that with Google right now. We were selected as a utility in NB Power to use that technology, drones, the ability to actually not even have to walk in the plant and get that, send back through remote devices.
Sure.
So no, much less exposure. So what we started at Pointe-le-Preau, I think we can build on that, and I'm looking forward to borrow. You spend the money on it, Jeff and Mike, and we're the smaller utility, yeah. Jeff, and then we'll get it.
We'll talk about
10 cents on the dollar, and then we'll put it at Pointe-le-Preau.
You know, that's the beauty of it, though, right? The things that we can do and we do together, when we share those things, it makes every one of us stronger.
Absolutely.
Jeff, how about at Darlington? Talk about the innovation there.
Yeah, oh, no, tremendous innovation. You know, where we're at right now, all three of us in this entire industry, is we should be relentlessly looking at technologies that are developing out there, not nuclear technologies, technologies across the board. And we know our plants, we know our problems. How do we take that and deploy it rapidly to solve a problem? And I've got a couple examples I want to share with you. But before I do that, you know, usually at 2 o'clock I check in on the Darlington refurb, see what's going on in the vault and how we're doing on pressure tubes. And if you turn around, I got a couple of our ex-lab guys back there in the lab coat. See them on that platform? One of you guys, put on the VR headset. I want to see what's going on in the vault at Darlington. You all want to come with me? Okay, let's have a look.
Let's put all our 3D glasses.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, make sure it's not Netflix. We know he likes to watch his movies.
Yeah. Here we go.
Oh, nice.
So look around. Yeah, so this is the vault. This is what's going on in the Darlington vault. We're doing pressure tube replacements. See that tooling right there? That's next generation tooling. That was done by ATS, working with SNC Lavalin. ATS is a Cambridge company, right? Those are Acon folks there. Replacing pressure tubes, and you can see where they are. They're past the midplane in the calandria, so we're in the second half of pressure tube install on this job. We're looking for safety issues. I watch this from my desk in the office, by the way. Okay, good. Thanks, guys. So here's virtual reality, and we're looking at the vault at Darlington. But the real point here is we can monitor those work activities for quality and performance from outside the vault, not suffer that radiation exposure. We map this with LIDAR, radar, all these areas of the plant, so we can do virtual plant walkdowns and take dimensions when engineers are doing modifications. You can link this to equipment explosion diagrams on the blowout parts, and so that the technology for oversight, for monitoring, for collaboration, to prepare for outages, just remarkable. And I'd share another, it doesn't just have to be outside in. There's nuclear industry invented technology. In Darlington, we are installing a first of a kind flow orifice, a new material, dissimilar metal welds in every one of the 480 feeders going to the calandria. So what? Well, the so what is that this new material has a much longer life, suffers much less degradation, less susceptibility to cracking, it takes less inspection, and as a result, it's going to reduce maintenance costs and shorten outage durations. First time deployment in Darlington, thanks to the efforts of SNC, BWXT, and Laker Energy, who were all involved in that series of events. That's a refurb-specific technology. You know, that equipment you saw in the vault there that's replacing those pressure tubes, in a collaboration effort between all the parties, including Bruce Power and OPG, we're taking the lessons learned from the Unit 2 refurbishment. We're redesigning that tooling for a new generation that instead of removing the pressure tube and the calandria tube in two separate processes on disassembly, we're going to be able to remove pressure tube and calandria tube and garter springs in one maneuver, volume reduce it, and get it in casks. That one tooling improvement will save 30 days on every subsequent refurb. 30 days. Think of that as $2 million a day. That's innovation.
Hmm. Now, speaking of collaboration, Mike, did you want to talk a little bit about that, about how everybody's working together to innovate together and how Bruce Power benefits from that? And
absolutely. You know, we're looking at a collaboration on a number of different levels, and it first starts with the things that we have in front of us, right, which is getting ready for our refurbishment. So as Gaetana and Jeff talked, right, we took the lessons learned from Bruce and Point La Prole and put them into Darlington, and now we've taken the Darlington lessons learned. Our tooling that's getting ready to deploy is one generation better than what's in use at Darlington. And with the virtual reality glasses and rooms, we'll actually be training that way. So where Jeff has a large investment in a mock-up that was necessary at that point in time, we've been able to innovate. Our mock-up's much smaller. We're using 3D technology, virtual reality technology, and we'll be able to start training our crews that way a lot differently. That enables them to get a real-life experience, both visually and using the tools with the advanced tool set. But we're also looking at how do we collaborate and work together when we buy things and when we do things. For a supplier community, when we come out to you for RFPs, and Bruce Power does engineering one way and has a process that requires 14 things, and OPG goes out with an RFP and requires 14 things that are all different, and Gaetan's are different than that, it causes you to do things in excess. In other words, you're duplicating, triplicating, sometimes embedding costs in your business to be able to handle us as separate entities, even though we have the same type of technology. So we're innovating around these techniques as an industry so that our training programs are consistent, the way we can bring folks in consistent, our procedures are somewhat consistent, so that you can standardize what you're doing no matter whose plant that you're working at. Then as we approach the future, I think it's the types of technologies that will truly pave that path forward. We have a lot of work going on in isotopes, which we think the isotope use and connection with the medical community is really a game changer for the industry. You see, we've always done this with cobalt, particularly from the Chalk River reactors. We sterilize today roughly 40% of all the once-use medical equipment around the world. And Richard Waynes from Nordion tells me that's equivalent to 100 billion syringes or about 10 billion pairs of surgical gloves, as an example. The chances are, if you've had surgery, any type of surgery, that equipment was sterilized by an isotope coming from Canada. And I think as we look forward to cancer treatments, we're already powering a gamma knife that does brain tumor treatment. We're looking at breast cancer treatments. We're looking at other delivery technologies now that can use the isotopes that we make for a variety of treatments, making them more accessible and less expensive. And we're looking now at other isotopes that are commonly used and needed around the world so that we can ensure that there's never a shortage or never a short supply or an affordability problem. So I think as we look through how we're advancing with innovation as an industry, we're doing well, and we would encourage the suppliers to keep bringing forward these ideas. As an example, we need one. Presently, when we have to look at our vacuum building, we have to take the units offline to do that. Why don't we have a robot that can do it while we're online all the time whenever we want it done? There's a challenge. If you have a solution, we're in a buying mode. So for suppliers out there, see Ian Rowley, right? Ian, I ask him this about twice a week, every week, right? It's those types of things that we can invent and create together, and I think it'll help us have a long, sustainable future.
Right on. Okay, let's talk about innovation when it comes to relations with First Nation communities. Maybe you could each comment on that, how you've been trying to advance those relationships. Gaetan?
Well, for us in New Brunswick, we actually developed a corporate strategy, and it's based on 3E. Okay, and they're looking for employment, and we said, well, before we get there, we need to engage them. So it's engagement, education, and employment. That's our strategy, three pillars. And we've developed some tactics for each of those strategic pillars. So on the engagement side, you know, I don't think there's much difference. You know, it's consultation, it's a set up a protocol. We have to help them with capacity funding, which we did, so that they can come to the table, you know, and get the facts and they participate. So that part is probably fairly standard. The education side, and I know I have to be careful when I use that word, but actually we had to educate ourselves first. you know, a lot of the cultural differences were that we were not really sensitive to their cultures. So, you know, the whole senior management team at NB Power went through a blanket exercise. How many people have gone to a blanket exercise here? You know what I talk about? It's actually incredibly a profound experience. And it's not just looking at a video, as you're walking on blankets and the blankets are disappearing and you're losing your babies. And I mean, it's it deepens the relationship. So it's not us educating First Nations, it's actually First Nation educating us. And that's how you build a trusting relationship. And obviously the employment factor is important. And you know, areas where we have struggled in the past is, for instance, in the construction industries. Very few First Nation members were members of the union. So we're working with the union members so that when we do build a refurbishment, that we have, you know, at least 5 to 7%, which is the population in New Brunswick. And in typical construction sites, we used to have less than 1%. So when you look at the well created by nuclear, they just want their peace. And with small modular reactors, we're now actually, you know, with the possibility of having burners, meaning fast reactors where you can actually burn the spent fuel, they're sitting on the fence, but they would consider supporting that. And that would be a major breakthrough for us to have First Nation supporting nuclear. So that's our strategy, 3 E's.
Okay, Mike?
I agree with everything that Gaetan said, and we're doing that. We've also taken some steps to create what we call an Indigenous Employees Network. So it's a support organization that once we have employment, that they can educate the rest of the population on cultural values, and at the same time, they can go into the communities and explain what it's like to work at a nuclear power plant. And when someone is newly hired, they're effectively a support group for that transition. Let's face it, how many folks have ever worked non-nuclear before, right? And then when you come into the nuclear arena, what happens? How many acronyms do you have to figure out in a matter of days, right? It's like it's a code language sometimes. So bridging that gap between non-nuclear and nuclear can be a daunting and a frightening step when you're not used to it. We've been able to double hiring in the last 2 years. Every year it goes up double, and this year we'll try to double it again for employees. And then we've reached out with the OCNI folks and have created the Indigenous Suppliers Network, where we've engaged with all the suppliers working at Bruce in a significant role and are working with them to be able to become not only employers, but also business partners. And a few weeks ago, we announced our first MOU with a startup construction company out of the Saugeen Ojibwa Nation. We also have a couple of manufacturers that have moved into the area and are now making plastic suits for us, among other devices that are used at Bruce Power, and OPG also has bought some of them. So we're continuing to expand that presence and that footprint and using real practical examples on what can be done when we collaborate and work together. And we see it reaching not only in the local communities, but reaching far out.
And I would like to add that I saw it in action yesterday. Is Desiree in the room? She may not be, okay, she was approaching me, and she said she was one of those form in kindergarten to your action, and she says, I've heard about Point Lepreau, and she wants to do work with us. So I promised her I would introduce her to Kathleen, but I have not been able to find the two together. But it is an fully Indigenous organization supplying materials, pop-up tents, apparently the only one in Canada doing that.
Yep.
I'm interested about those pop-up tents, and I'm glad to hear that it's led by Indigenous.
And it's all innovation. They took effectively what was a packing plant in Paisley, Ontario, that had burned down and had been vacant for 13 years. They've renovated it, and they've turned it into a manufacturing facility. Now they're employing people in a very small town, and they're growing, and these tents and other things are innovations that are coming out of their company.
Wasn't staged at all, by the way, Mike.
Doesn't have to be. Yeah. Jeff?
You know, when I think about relationships with First Nations, I think about the underlying principle that we always do better if we work in partnership. It is very rare that one individual or one company is able to complete something monumental by themselves. And so partnership, I think, is one of the key characteristics to a successful endeavor, to a successful mega project, anything. So our approach, and I think it's a growing approach, at the heart of our business is partnership. And that's what we try to do with First Nations. So if you look at the last series of hydroelectric projects we built, we have First Nations equity partners, owners of the facility, so that they stand up a corporation, they develop the skills to finance it, they own the equity, they're involved in the operation, and they collect a generations-long revenue stream that makes the community more healthy. Puts us in a position to develop First Nations-owned businesses to compete and secure contracts in support of the project. And we target hiring First Nation community members so that they can get the job skills and training to carry on long after the project. We've had First Nation community members come on board on a project as an apprentice and leave as a journeyman and take those skills with them. This week, we are declaring commercial our Nanticoke solar facility. Grid-scale solar built on the location of the coal pile of the former Nanticoke coal generating station. That project is 15% owned by Six Nations and 10% owned by the Mississauga of the New Credit. And so I think there's untapped potential here if we think about this as a partnership, and it applies not just to First Nations, although it importantly applies there. It applies to the way we approach anything we do in the future, particularly the future of new nuclear.
Okay, let's talk about the supply chain and and what you need from the supply chain in terms of innovation and how what you need from associations, from leaders to help your refurbishments be successful and to allow you to innovate to the max, basically. Mike?
Yeah, I'll talk specifically about that. With the refurbishments that are going on now in Ontario, there's been a business opportunity created that hasn't effectively been there for decades. With that comes the ability to recapitalize and implement new equipment, but it also means growth. So as we're growing together, that means we have to refocus ourselves on a few things. We have newcomers coming into our organizations. They're having to learn nuclear, right? They're having to learn the acronyms. They're having to learn about safety standards that didn't exist maybe in their workplace that they're coming from. They're having to learn about the importance of quality and what quality means, not only to the near term, but how quality actually sustains us for long-term operation and provides us with the ability to talk about things like new nuclear. We have to teach them what it means from a schedule perspective and why working to a schedule is so important. And it's a simple thing. It's like we're all in an orchestra because we're doing so many things as from a refurbishment or a major component replacement, we all have a role to play. If we're all playing off the same sheet of music and we're in a symphony, sounds like a beautiful song. If we all play to a different tune, it sounds like a bunch of noise. And a schedule is so important from that aspect. In being able to manage our funding such that we have the ability to keep renewing and putting forward new investments into innovations and new technologies as we go forward. So the industries that new folks are coming from may have some of those components, but in our business, I think they take that specific order of safety, quality, schedule, and cost, and that's what helps us to be sustainable for the long term. And I think as we grow, that quality component is very important to ensure that it's managed in the near term, because between safety and quality, those two things are the enabler of our future.
And we can't do that individually. We all have to work together on it to keep improving every day, getting better at what we do and innovating new ideas and new products.
Okay, Jeff?
I couldn't say it any better. I think what we need from the supply chain is innovation. You know, we're in a decade where we're going to see rapid change in technology. Much of that technology is going to be developed for use by people around the world, not specifically for nuclear. But we need this supply chain to be looking out there, to be creative, to be quick to move, to identify innovations that can make a difference in our nuclear industry and get them to us. I guarantee you, if you have a winning technology, if you have a winning innovation, robotic inspection of vacuum buildings, if you've got it, bring it. Mike will adopt it. He'll instantly call me on the phone. You'll have two customers, and then we'll call Gaetan, and that'll be three. That's what we need from the supply chain.
What about from the associations and leaders in the industry?
I think the leadership in this industry and the associations have done a remarkable job at getting us to a very solid foundation for the Canadian nuclear industry and at helping us make that first decision that I talked about, the decision to invest $30 billion plus in creating a new 50-year life for this industry in Canada. I think what we need from all of us now is to get aligned around what we want the future of new nuclear to look like in Canada and be clear about the impact that that can have on greenhouse gas reduction, on security, and on the economy, and be sending that message to policymakers at the federal level, at the provincial level, and between Canada and the U.S., because there will be an opportunity and there will be a right time to move forward with that technology. But if that window opens and we're not all aligned and ready to run right through it, we'll miss the opportunity.
Kind of agree with that.
Okay.
Is Ron Oberth in the room? Oh. Ron here. Ron, John Barrett, round of applause. You guys have done great.
Well, I just want to add quickly, I mean, they've covered it so well. They're the experts. We benefit from their supply chain. Like 96%, I was told by Jeff yesterday, this morning, is in Canada. So how many industry can say that? But I would also add one thing. Do not sit on your laurels, because with the advent of technology like 3D printing, it would be easy for somebody to come up with a solution that will save us $2 million a day, and the cost of Point Lepreau in the winter is $2 million a day as well. When you think about that, you know, there's a lot of thing at stake here, and we can't sit on our laurels. We have to keep innovating, because I think 3D printing is gonna change our industry tremendously.
Hmm. Okay, what about SMRs? Will they change the industry tremendously? Can you talk, Jeff, a little bit about how you see that unfolding and how it will help Canada achieve its long-term goals?
Yeah, I believe that there's a range of technologies that are going to be necessary for nuclear to really fully serve the role it can in the future. So as an example, I think there's an ongoing place for CANDU technology. We've got such a tremendous supply chain, a developed technology. I think only now are we demonstrating the potential of it. And I think we should be careful to maintain that technology, because I think there are applications where it's going to be a fit here in Canada and around the world. But secondly, I think there is going to be a growing appetite for a smaller, modular, grid-scale reactor design. You know, we all know the advantages of these. If they can be largely factory-built, we can drive out a lot of the construction risk. If they can be delivered on time and on schedule, we can hit the mark with the project plan. Mm-hmm. They are of a scale that you can use them to grow as demand grows without having to build excess and take time to grow into it. And they are much more straightforward in terms of capital for companies to take on in terms of that risk. They can be built without betting the company. So I think that is a really important piece of the puzzle, and it's got to be developed, and I think we all should be looking to try to have something in service before we hit 2030. Just the last couple of comments, very small modular reactors, 5, 10, 15 megawatts, very passive technologies. Another application that is critically important, remote communities, mining operations. There are plenty of jurisdictions around the world where that's a perfect fit. And then the last thing I'd say here is there are longer-term technologies. Gaetan's mentioned them. Fast reactors, breeder reactors, various technologies that if we have a growing commitment to nuclear and we're building a bigger fleet, will make sense because they help us not close the fuel cycle, but reduce the footprint and lifetime of nuclear spent fuel. I think they're all important, and they're not in competition. We as an industry have to make sure we can articulate the roles they play and the time horizons they're going to play that role for policymakers.
And I agree with everything that Jeff just said. And I think small modular reactors serve an important role in terms of being able to provide clean energy that's affordable for the many, right? For countries that are developing. Other forms of clean energy can be unaffordable. When you look at the investment as an example that Germany has made, it's been billions upon billions, including the subsidies, and you see the emissions rate continuing to increase in Germany. Frank Saunders had some slides on that. California as well invested billions upon billions, and you can see that the carbon content is still much, much higher than Ontario, with electric rates that are much, much more expensive. So if we are to address climate change, the affordability piece has to be a component. I think this is where the small modular reactor makes a lot of sense for developing countries, to have a good mix of clean energy components, and also keep to balance out the ability to afford the clean electricity. What we don't want to create in this process is energy poverty, right? So we move from one form of poverty to another form of poverty. And I think the small modular reactor has a role in helping us to do that.
Gaetan?
And for us, we're so excited because we are finished with our refurbishment. So, you know, we are now getting the performance we want. We are on a year that is the second best in our history. We have a shot of actually being the best year in our history. And I mean, for me, it's a great satisfaction because our team at Point Lepreau has delivered something that it will operate better than the first 25 years. How many components, how many things you even think about equipment that, you know, runs better the second half of their life? And that's what refurbishment is doing for us. But we're over that, and we have to think of the future. And Jeff made a good point about, you know, the scaling of this thing. When you are a smaller grid, you know, you can't build, you know, a 1,000 megawatt when the grid is 4,000 megawatts. So you have to do it in smaller increments. We also have to deal with the renewable. There is so much renewable now. It's so popular. You know, we're getting into 15, 20, 30%. We need something that will be able to follow that. And a combination of renewable as part of the solution, smart grid, and new nuclear, small modular reactors will be a perfect fit for smaller region like ours. But also new regions. Like, you know, if you want to go to Saskatchewan, you know, you don't start with 1,000 megawatts. You have to start with smaller and the inherent safety features. I mean, CANDU is very, very, very safe. But these are safer. And you know, some people call them walk-away reactors. So when you look at the possibility of dealing with the spent fuel, which is the only thing that we're left with that people have some questions in North America, and we will resolve it, but think about it, having a new technology that has the potential to actually reuse the fuel that we only use a small percentage, that really excites me. And we think that in New Brunswick, we have an ideal market for it. You know, we have a site that is pre-approved. We have a lot of coal left in the region. New England badly needs some base load in the future. And Jeff and I were talking, maybe dreaming, you know, this morning, but we're looking at how we could get right from East Ontario through Quebec to the Maritime in New England. Maybe make a new country? like something, you know? Don't know what language we'll be speaking, but...
Maybe you can include Tennessee in that.
And we will make a little tour to Tennessee, because we think that the mindset that we need to do that is we shouldn't be picking one resource versus another. We should be picking the most logical resource.
Right.
And small modular reactors, we're talking the ability to get a base load at 7 cents a kilowatt hour. Maybe not the first one. And this is, again, we'll learn and we'll maybe they'll bill on us in Ontario after. But hey, as long as they send it back to us at 10 cents on the dollar, we're okay.
We are going to.
I'm always negotiating, by the way.
Yeah, I know it.
We are going to get to your questions in a moment. So if you have a question, we will have microphones available for a couple of minutes. But maybe before we do that, what would you each say is the most important message that you'd want to leave people with today? Mike?
Yeah, there's a bright future if we all work together. And we have to continue to work together and collaborate, which means a supplier community, right? We call it competimates. Some days you're going to be competing. Some days you're going to have to partner to deliver the solutions we need, not only for the near term, but for the long term. And it's events like this where that networking becomes so important and ideas can be hatched, products can be created, solutions can be found. And I just am so positive about where we're going as an industry and the future that we have if we stay connected with each other and we keep striving for that goal of clean energy, affordable energy, and medical isotopes and building that bright future.
Okay, Gaetan?
In Canada, you know, we're 82% non-emitting, so we're leading the way. But in order to maintain that and to contribute every more, to get to the 100%, that is actually the goal, like zero carbon. And nuclear is a big part of the solution. And we believe between Ontario and New Brunswick, and maybe a bit of Tennessee, we have the experience and the capability to create a complete new, a second life. And I agree with Mike, so it's so bright and it's so logical that I think the biggest issue will be the engagement and how do we get First Nations completely on board. And we resolve the First Nation engagement and we build the kind of relationship that OPG and Bruce and us are building, but throughout the country, like Saskatchewan, Alberta. Because the 100%, we can't talk about Ontario and New Brunswick. We gotta bring Saskatchewan, Nova Scotia, and Alberta. And once we make that progress, Canada will be a world leader, and we'll draw more load here. Electrification, IT, all the blockchain, all the the IT related stuff. Mm-hmm. You know, that's going to grow exponentially, and they will want to be in the Googles of the world will want to be in a country that is clean, but also cost competitive. And nuclear allows that to occur in this beautiful country.
Jeff.
Yeah, well, I've got to tell you, you all probably know, this is my last CNA meeting in the OPG CEO chair. So I'll be turning this over, and I'll be moving on to take the CEO role at the Tennessee Valley Authority. So I wanted to say a few things to the group here. Although this is my last CNA meeting as OPG CEO, I hope it's not my last CNA meeting. So I'm just telling John Barrett and company, if you invite me back, I'll come, John. And I must tell you, my wife Tracy and I have loved every minute we've spent here in Canada. It's a fantastic country, great people, wonderful nuclear industry. Like Christine Savinicki this morning, we took up curling. We're in the Friday Night Curling League. Tracy has a much better draw than I do, I can tell you that. Prime Minister Trudeau said something that sums it up for me, and it is, the world needs a little more Canada. And I think the international nuclear industry needs a little more Canadian nuclear industry in it. You know, at the dawn of this commercialization of nuclear power, Canada was there. With innovation and determination, you brought the CANDU reactor to the world and all the remarkable technology that flowed from that design. And that same innovation and that same determination is still here today. Gone are the 90s when the Canadian nuclear ship floundered and the industry looked elsewhere for talent, including the US. You didn't need it then and you don't need it now. This is a strong, technically competent industry who's capable of moving this into the future. And I think that's where you're standing today. And I hope to see this continue. These are three very strong power companies. And I gotta say, as I was growing up in the 60s and 70s, and no insult to the millennials, I'm gonna talk for the end of the baby boomer generation. I'm a baby boomer. You know, that generation that invented the internet and the mobile phone and the PC, ended the Cold War, closed the hole in the ozone layer, stopped acid rain, got pesticide contamination, or you know, those folks. But as I grew up in the 60s and 70s, even then, I was looking north and picking my favorite pyro trio. And here's who my favorite pyro trio was then. You know these guys. This is Rush, right? Geddy Lee, Eric Lifeson, and Neil Peart. And my favorite pyro trio. Well, my favorite pyro trio now is OPG, Bruce Power, and NB Power. And we have collaborated so well as organizations. And Mike and Gaetan have gotten so personally close. You may not know it, but at one point in this, we formed our own tribute band. And I just want to show you our press photo. I mean, look at this. Mike's got hair. I've got a 30-inch waist. And Gaetan, he's just always got it going on. So, you know, just we called it Rash because those 70s leather pants are not very comfortable. In fact, that's what ended the band. But my point, please get that off the screen. But that's my favorite power trio. Here's what I would suggest. I would suggest your homegrown new OPG CEO, Ken Hartwick, is going to join this band. And I don't know, maybe next year, where's Mark Lisinski? Is he in the room? Mark's here somewhere, I know. Maybe we add Mark and make it a quartet. In that case, I'd advocate Led Zeppelin. And then, if you invite me back from TVA and we get a partnership going, we can make it a quintet, then it can be the Rolling Stones. Okay, all right, but just before I move on, just for my friends to make sure they don't forget this, I'm giving them each their own version.
Well,
guys,
thank you.
Thank you. Michael.
Thank you.
Okay. And as if that wasn't enough, I just want to say one more thing. I want to thank John Barrett for his service. John has been at the head of this organization for 5 years, done a remarkable job. And for those of you who don't see the inner workings of this, here's an individual who has to satisfy 100 different companies that are part of this association. He's got 100 masters to serve. Thank God he was trained as an ambassador during his time with the IAEA. It served him well. John, you've done a fantastic job, and I wanted to thank you. And I know Mike and Gaetan do as well.
Yeah, John. I would echo that. I think, you know, everybody gets to a point in their career where they're deciding what they want to do next. So we were chatting some about, is this retirement? And John says, no, I think I'm just going to take a break from nuclear for about a few days, and we'll get back into doing something else, but you'll see me around. And hey, when you look at what's been done over the past years, right, we took an industry that was somewhat at times fractured, and now it's unified, and we have a solid foundation where significant amounts of capital are being attracted into the industry and invested. Right? It's a massive, massive display of trust in this industry to put forth the type of expenditures that we have ongoing to renew ourselves. And with that, the economic development that's been created all throughout the provinces, it's causing industry to flourish. It's creating jobs, creating employment, improving conditions. And John, your leadership, as Jeff said, getting the cats herded together, which is all of us, and getting us a vision and a path forward has been outstanding. So we as an industry appreciate what you've done very much, and we look forward to seeing you.
And it's hard to add to that, but, you know, I echo my colleagues here. But John, for us, you know, obviously, I remember the days when the CEO of NV Power had to sit between the CEO of Bruce and OPG. It's not the same case, you know, they can. So, but you took us in a time when, you know, when there was actually a lot of questions. You know, the Point Le Pro didn't go as well as we wanted. And to walk us, lead us through this difficult thing, and now we have positive decisions in Ontario. Boat refurbishments are going. I know Mike can't stop. He told me he spent already hundreds of millions of dollars on it, so it's committed. He's got the deal to do it. What you had to do is in French, we have a term called rassembleur. You are a wonderful rassembleur, gatherer. I don't know what the English would be, but it's phenomenal to take hundreds of people and, you know, different cohorts, like, you know, this rock band, you know, and getting to play together, even if none of us can sing. that is quite a task. And I wish you the best on behalf of all the people in this room. That's my role. All the people that have great respect for you on all your future endeavors. And I know we're going to see more. But I'm going to ask you one more favor before you retire, okay? You make this guy an honorary member, because him and his wife, Tracy, are really exemplary. Canadian at least want to be, because they both adopted curling and, you know, to be part of the community, and I think they deserve to come here every year. So Tracy and Jeff, I'm putting pressure on you, John, to do one more thing, okay? And to thank you. There is something that we have a token, but I don't know what it is, so I'm...
Well, actually, let's get John up here, because, John, I know you have something that you want to say as well, right?
Okay.
So let's bring John up here, because John wants to share something.
Now, yeah, I'm totally speechless, because this has gone in a different direction than I was thinking more about. You heard the references to Tennessee, and I'm sorry you gave it away, because I was wondering how many people here are thinking, what on earth has Tennessee got to do with this discussion? But it is the fact that, as Jeff said, he's leaving. And I wanted to add a couple of personal words, very briefly, but very heartfelt. And for me, when I'm thinking about Jeff Elias, a man who's focused on the goal, the refurbishment of the unit at Darlington on time, on budget, one of the first long discussions we had together, we go into his office, and I look around, and it is absolutely spotlessly clean and organized. And it's a big office, of course. And there's this whiteboard. And on that is absolute hieroglyphics, as far as I'm concerned. And Jeff is there studying it. That was the master plan. That was before the breaker. It was open, but that was where he wanted to go. And he was, like, laser-focused on that. And we've seen that over the last couple of years, what that focus is like. And setting the standards, I think you all recall the time when he called a halt to work and brought to account contractors and suppliers on the question of safety and other fulfillment of contracts, and I guess read a kind of a riot act enough to be able to say, you've got to do better, and everyone has done better. And I think that took a lot of courage, but it was the timing of it. the early stage, to say, no, we're going to do this right. Addressing the social license for nuclear, I mean, you've heard how he speaks, you've heard how they all speak. I mean, this is a lesson in public speaking. And to be able to speak to so many public audiences and explain the public good that comes from the technology, and with all three of them, with the authority of an operator. These people are very different. They actually know from experience what they're talking about. So I think that's a powerful part of the authenticity when you're trying to get a public message out. It took the innovation of the practical realm, and not just in robotics, but in isotopes, and we heard about that in the discussion. And you continue to see the longer term of the future. I think this was the great thing about this panel, is we touched on all these things, and again, all three panelists have been deeply involved in the new nuclear. They may not have called it that, maybe we weren't talking about that so much the last couple of years. Now we are talking about it, and these are the orchestrators of the new nuclear. A courteous gentleman, affable, good-humored, you saw that with what he just put up on the screen there, engaging, always ready to discuss and explain and encourage. And I, personally, and many others, benefited from his advice and his help. And the only regret is that he's leaving before coaching the Leafs to the Stanley Cup. Some of you may know that reference. But
I'll keep in contact with Babcock.
We'll that's right. So all of us, Jeff, at this conference, thank you for your leadership, enormous impact and contribution, not just in putting the refurbished project solidly on track, but on all aspects of OPG's work. So we wish you well in your new position at TVA. We hope to see you back in Canada, and yes, Gaetan and Mike, I am giving you the honorary CNA emeritus status. Help me with this. Whatever it might be, but you are permanently invited here. In fact, we might tie you down. You can't leave anyway.
Thank you very much.
Thank you, John.
Okay. Well, why don't we stop there? Okay. That's a very nice, touching way to wrap up this discussion. But Jeff, thank you for everything. Mike, Gaetan, thank you for being on this panel.